Hi everybody, Dr. A back with part two of the venipuncture video, and we're going to go through the procedure. So we had started with greeting and identifying the patient and talked about requisitions and so on, and we had gotten to the point where you had palpated and located a site to stick. Okay, so recap the last slide. Veins are best located by palpation or feel rather than by sight. The median cubital vein is the first choice, cephalic vein is the second choice, and the basilic vein is the third choice. Other than that, your options are usually the back of the round hand or maybe the wrist. Gently push up and down with the index finger on the vein. This can help determine the depth, width, and direction of the veins. Veins will feel spongy, bouncy, and firm, and then remove the tourniquet once you have found a vein. So next you're going to clean the site. You're going to use 70% isopropyl alcohol or another antiseptic. Isopropyl alcohol is the widest available and the cheapest, and it is very effective. You want to clean the area in concentric circles that are spiraling, meaning you start in the middle of the site and you are going round and round, bigger and bigger, and cleaning out. You want to allow the site to air dry for a maximum bacteriostatic action, and don't blow on it because you have, you know, microbes and germs in your mouth and stuff. So let it air dry. And this is another reason why usually you want to take the tourniquet off, that you can allow plenty of time for it to dry. Also, if it's still wet, it hasn't taken full effect. And if you stick a patient and the site is still wet with alcohol, it'll actually sting more and hurt the patient more. So while it's drying and the patient hopefully is sitting still, the arm is still, you can assemble your equipment near the arm and then reapply the tourniquet if it was removed during the cleansing process, and uncap the needle and take a quick look at the needle. Make sure there aren't any defects, and you know, you're not supposed to recap it. You're going to use it right then. If there is a defect and you cannot use it, you want to activate the safety shield, get rid of it, and just get a different one. Next, we're going to perform the venipuncture. So you want to anchor the vein by gently pulling on the skin and pulling it taut with the thumb of the non-dominant hand. So you're just kind of holding it in place, making sure it's not going to roll. Again, the median cubital usually doesn't roll, but it's not a bad idea to just hold it. You want to hold a needle assembly with your dominant hand, with a tube inserted up to the line on the adapter without pushing it onto that second needle. And with your thumb on top of the adapter and your index fingers close to the front of the holder and your other fingers gently grasping the underside. You want to hold it at about a 30 to 45 max degree angle from the patient's arm. So you don't want to go too flat. You don't want to go down too much. You don't want to go at a right angle, and you don't want to go down flat. You want to just kind of get a happy medium there, and you'll get used to it, to what works best. You're going to insert a needle with the bevel up, so the slice of the needle is facing up. And you want to insert it in a smooth, quick motion. You will feel a slight give when the needle enters the vein. Again, so this is something that you get used to feeling in your fingers as you perform the procedure. You want to hold the needle assembly steady by resting the fingers that are on the bottom of the hub or of the needle assembly or syringe on the patient's arm. So you can see in this picture here, this is really well done. And so this is actually kind of anchoring your hand. And this will prevent you from pulling the needle out as you switch tubes, pulling them on and off the hub. It'll allow you to be really steady. So you want to fill the first tube by pushing the tube in with a hand that anchored the vein, so the non-dominant hand. You've let go of the vein because you're in the vein now, so you don't need to hold it anymore. And now you're going to use that hand to push the tubes on and remove them. So to clearly see the blood as it flows into the tube, you want to insert a tube with the manufacturer's label facing down, so you can really see how much blood's in there and how it's filling. And most people will use their thumb to push the tube in. It seems to be the most effective way to do it. be sure that while you push the tube in, you're also kind of pulling back with your fingers on the flanges of the adapter while you push the tube in to prevent pushing the needle in farther. So you have kind of like an opposing force thing. The point of it is to keep the needle as still as possible and in the vein in its location. This is so that you can push the tubes on and off the needle assembly without moving the needle in the patient's arm and losing your position in the vein. So you remove the tube once blood stops flowing into it. That means the vacuum has pulled the adequate amount of blood in it. Do make sure that it filled up correctly and that you didn't stop because you actually moved the needle and pulled out. So gently pull the tube to remove it off the needle assembly. It also helps to push against the flange on the end of the holder as you pull the tube off. Keep the needle assembly as still as possible and then insert the next tube. While the next tube is filling, if the previous tube contained an additive, mix it gently by inverting it 5 to 10 times as soon as it is removed. Keep filling the tubes in the order of draw until you have filled all the required tubes. Then you're going to remove the tourniquet. So the tourniquet can be removed after blood begins flowing into the first tube. If blood flow is slow or the collection of all tubes will be complete within a minute, the tourniquet can remain on the arm. The tourniquet must be removed before the needle is removed from the vein or blood will squirt everywhere. And to remove the tourniquet, you're going to pull on the free short end of the tourniquet to release it from the patient's arm. And so that's called what I call popping the tourniquet, because you just pull it and it pops off. And you're going to remove the last tube before removing the needle. So this picture actually has it wrong, because that tube is still on the needle, and if you leave it on there, blood could drip out. So you really want to pull that tube off and then pull the needle out. When you pull the needle out, you want to pull the needle assembly straight out from the patient's arm, and then you immediately activate the safety feature. Apply at the same time, you're going to apply a gauze square folded in quarters to the puncture site, potentially a cotton ball, whatever your facility is using. And you are going to dispose of the used needle collection device in the appropriate waste container, which is usually your sharps. And sometimes the sharps is within reach and sometimes it's not. So if it's not within reach, put the safety activated needle collection device somewhere away from the patient where you can see it. And then when you get up, you can put it into the sharps container. You want to label each tube at the patient's bedside or in the drawing room in the presence of the patient. So depending, you know, patient's bedside, if it's an inpatient, at the patient's in the drawing room, if it's an outpatient, but you stay with them. Some facilities, like one of the reference labs that I go to have my blood drawn, will have the patient look at the tubes and look that they are indeed labeled with their name, and they'll make you look at all the tubes, make sure that all the tubes have your name and date of birth, and they're, you know, labeled, they're yours, and then you have to sign the paper saying that you saw that they properly labeled the tubes. You always want to use a ballpoint pen or a permanent marker. Obviously, most places now have requisitions with barcoded labels, and you want to use the barcoded labels. Make sure you put the barcode up and down so it can be easily read on the tube. And never, ever, ever label a tube before collection, but also don't walk away from the patient with unlabeled tubes. You really need to have a form of identification on the tube before you walk away from the patient. And then you're going to attend to the patient, check the puncture site to make sure bleeding has stopped. Some patients might be on some anticoagulants and may take longer to stop bleeding. You want to dispose of all contaminated materials in a biohazard container. So that's, you know, we've already supposedly, hopefully, disposed of the needle, but that means the gauze, the alcohol wipes, anything that remains, the cap of the needle, all of that needs to be collected and disposed of. If you like don't find the cap of the needle, it's possible in an inpatient that the cap of that needle could have rolled underneath the patient, and if they lay on that for hours on end, it can create a bed sore. So it's really important to not leave little things in the patient's bed. You want to place all specimens in either a bag marked with biohazard or some tube holders. Tube holders are the best because they keep the tubes up and down and keep blood away from the lid, and that prevents aerosolization of the blood if the tube is opened. Next, you remove your gloves and wash your hands, your hand hygiene, and you thank the patient on your way out. So lastly, you're going to deliver the specimen. So you want to follow the lab's policy about recording your work in a computer logbook or other tracking system. It's often referred to as checking the samples in, accessioning the samples in, and in that it logs the time that it arrived in the lab. You also are logging the time you specifically collected the sample, and then who collected it. Usually the person collecting it often is a person logging it in, but in some larger facilities, it could be a different person checking the stuff in. And that person would be working in central in central processing. So so that wraps it up, and then the testing phase, processing phase will begin, and then the testing phase will begin. So a little note on routine venipuncture with a syringe. So patients with fragile veins may need to have a blood drawn using a syringe because the stronger vacuum of the evacuated tube may collapse the vein. This can be especially true for elderly people. The steps are similar from the tourniquet tying all the way to cleaning the site. To prepare the syringe, you want to always pull on the plunger once or twice to make sure that it can move pretty freely, because sometimes in manufacturing that rubber part of the plunger kind of sticks to the barrel of the syringe. You fill the syringe by pulling on the plunger evenly and gently to withdraw the blood. So you want to kind of just have a slow, steady, if you pull too hard on that syringe, especially one, you could collapse the vein because now you're creating a stronger vacuum and you could hemolyze the blood. And so make sure that you firmly place the hand, brace the hand that's holding the barrel against the patient's arm so that only the plunger moves and you're not pulling the needle out of the patient. And you do want to remove the tourniquet to prevent bruising, because if you are using a syringe and the patient's veins are more fragile, then they're going to be more prone to bruising also. After the blood is drawn with a syringe, the needle safety shield is activated. You do not want to use the same needle to transfer the blood into the tube. So activate the safety device and remove that needle. And then you want to use a needleless blood transfer device to transfer the blood to the tubes. And it's not 100% needleless because there's actually a needle in the inside of that hub. But it's a safety device. It's called a blood transfer device. And you transfer the blood to evacuated tubes in the same order of draw as if you had used the multi-sample evacuated tube system. You place your tubes in your tube holder, rack, or bag, and you're going to dispose of the syringe and the transfer device together in the appropriate sharps container. And you're going to complete the procedure, which was checking on the patients, labeling the tubes, wash hands, etc. And then some notes on doing a routine venipunctures with a winged infusion set, also called a butterfly needle. This type of needle is ideal for the collection from small and fragile veins, such as those on the back of the hand. You want to use the same procedure as the needle assembly device, except you hold the device by the wings instead of the hub. It is also possible to use a syringe attached to the winged infusion set. If you're using the evacuated collection tube, you want to use a discard tube, which is usually a plain red tube, as your first tube, to pull the air through, out of the tubing and get the tubing full of blood before you start filling your first tube. Because if you don't, then your first tube, which is often a blue top, will be short draw, and that will mess up the testing and can cause a sample to be rejected. So if you used a butterfly, always have a discard tube first. So other than that, it's really the exact same procedure that we've already outlined. So anyway, so that wraps up our venipuncture. Thank you so much for your kind attention.